much for joining me. I'm certainly glad you did, because this happens to be my first ever reading wrap-up. I figured it would be better if I make seasonal wrap-ups rather than monthly ones, because what if 1 month I read one book and then the other month I read 10 books? It would make more sense if I make a seasonal wrap-up. So without further ado, let's get started. And the first book that I'm going to be talking about is The Perks of Being a Wallflower, and I am going to say a few bad things about it, but please stay with me, because I'm going to explain myself. The Perks of Being a Wallflower is my favorite movie. I love it so much. I watched the first when I was 14, I think, and at the time I saw that there's actually a book that it's based on, and I was like, okay, should I read the book? No, I shouldn't. I've already watched the film. And that's a stupid position, and I get that. I've abandoned it. But at the age of 14, I was a stupid little girl, and I thought that I shouldn't read the book. Well, this is silly, and if I kept this position, I would have never read Pride and Prejudice, just because I've already watched Bridget Jones' Diary. I was re-watching this movie again and again, and with every time of rewatching it, it was becoming more and more relevant to me. So the last time I rewatched this movie, I was like, this is so good, I want to read a book as well. And so I read the book, and bear with me, I think that the film is much better than the book. Maybe the thing is just that the story is better as a film rather than as a book version. Because Charlie, the main character, is a boy with PTSD, and he's constantly having flashbacks of something painful that happened to him. And I just think that flashbacks is a better thing to show when you're filming a movie rather than when you're writing a book. But that's not the only reason why I like the film more. The other reason is because there's Emma Watson in the film, and there's no Emma Watson involved in the book. Okay, the actual reason is that there were a couple of scenes that were not included in the film, but they were in the original book, that I didn't like. The first one is the day Charlie meets Sam, who's played by Emma Watson, who's Charlie's crush. At this exact night, Charlie's having a dream of Sam laying naked around him, and when he wakes up, he's like, oh my god, that's too bad, I didn't want this dream to happen, that's disrespectful, and I should tell Sam about it. And when he goes and tells Sam that he had this dream, all Sam does in response is laughs and goes, Charlie, you know I'm too old for you, right? So stop thinking about me in this way. And Steven Chbosky, I am now speaking to you, Steve, my guy. Do you think this is how a woman would reply to a situation like this? If some middle schooler came to me, looked me dead in the eyes and said that he had a dream of me being naked around him, the age gap wouldn't be the first thing that came to my mind. The other scene that I didn't like, there is a character, Mary Elizabeth, who's just in their friend group, and she, right from the start, we get the idea of her that she's this strong and independent woman. She doesn't care what you think about her. She loves feminist stuff, movies, books, etc., etc. And we love to see that, but apparently Steven Chbosky doesn't, because at some point Charlie starts dating Mary Elizabeth, and when he starts dating her, he's asking Sam about some advices, what he should tell to her, what he should give her like as a gift, and Sam tells him that whatever you do, don't tell her that she's pretty or beautiful, because she thinks that she's way more than just a pretty girl and she doesn't want to be perceived like that. And I love to see that. That's a great attitude to have for a character like this. But then at some point, Mary Elizabeth has some sort of breakdown, and she's asking Charlie if he thinks she's beautiful or not. And now, again, speaking to the author, why build this strong and independent character who doesn't care about anything if you're gonna make her care? That doesn't make any sense, and I'm very glad that it was cut from the movie version. There were also a couple of scenes that were in the book and weren't in the film. I'm not gonna tell everything about them, But I'm just gonna say that these are quite disturbing scenes, and if you want to read the book, you should definitely check the trigger warnings for it. And I don't think that it's a bad thing to include in a book like this, because Charlie says at the ending, the famous line, "There is so much pain in the world and I don't know how to not notice it." And these scenes, they are painful, and it makes sense because he has witnessed so many painful things, and he doesn't know how to not notice them. But still, I'm glad that they were cut from the movie, because I wouldn't like to watch and look at things like this. But overall, I'm so glad that this book happened, because it's a great story, it's a great representation, and whatever I said, I love the characters. They're so good. They're almost too good to be true. Like Sam and Patrick? People like this don't exist. So I gave this book 4 out of 5 stars. The next thing I've read was The Bell Jar by Sylvia Plath, and I read it for my first video that I made for this channel, reading books from Maeve Wiley's reading list. And I don't think that I've expressed enough how much I like this book in that video. Because ever since the day I've read it, I haven't stopped thinking about it. I've reread some scenes, I've memorized the lines, I want quotes from it tattooed on my body. "To the person in the bell jar, blank and soft as a dead baby, the world itself is the bad dream." Yes. I loved it very much. Once again, if you haven't read it,
what are you waiting for?
Read it. And it will change your life, I hope, as well as it changed mine. I'm now gonna recommend this book to every person that asks me about it, and I'm gonna reference it, and I am gonna associate myself with the main character, and no one's gonna put an end to it. Next, I've read 2 works by Virginia Woolf, which are Mrs. Dalloway and A Room of One's Own. I wouldn't say that it's the easiest thing to read Virginia Woolf, but it's definitely very interesting and very beneficial for you. A Room of One's Own was a very informative work. It's an essay about women in literature, both as authors and characters, and it has some very interesting points, and I think that every woman should read this essay. I'm very glad that my first video encouraged me to do this. Mrs. Dalloway as well was not the easiest read, but it was definitely interesting. It had a lot of symbols, and it was interesting in finding them and pointing them out and analyzing them. Next, I also read 2 works by Shakespeare, which are Macbeth and Othello. And I don't really have much to say about them, because I also read them for my videos. I'm just still on my journey of reading Shakespeare works and finding the one that I like the most. So these were just a couple from a London list. I'm again very glad that I've read them, because they are one of the most popular works of Shakespeare, and people often talk about them, reference them, use some lines from them, so I'm definitely glad that I've read them. The next work that I'm also glad that I've read is 1984 by George Orwell. And I think I was harsh when I gave it 3 out of 5 stars on Goodreads, because I'm still thinking about it. I still remember some lines and things from this book, and I'm still analyzing it when I think about politics. And I'm thinking that, like, some events that happen in our days right now is something very similar to what George Orwell wrote in his book 1984. So again, it wasn't enjoyable while I was reading it, but I'm certainly glad I did, because it is too often referenced. Next one is also a book that I've read for my video on Daria Morgan's Offer, which is Metamorphosis by Franz Kafka. This became one of my favorite, well, I can't say really books, because it's a very short, like, story. And it's good in every aspect. It's short, it's interesting, it's gripping, it's gloomy enough, sad enough, and I love things like this, so I was glad to add it to my favorites bookshelf. Next thing I've read was 3 Men in the Boat, I wouldn't say that it's a book that leaves you, like, thinking about it. It's more a book that leaves you remembering some scenes from it, because it's not really, there isn't really any plot. It's just like a couple of stories, and it's a comedy book. Like, it's not meant to be deep or meaningful. It's a funny book, but I can't say it was too relatable because I don't know much about English men sailing in like 1950s. Still, it was a fun read, a good break from something deep and meaningful, something to analyze and stuff. This was just light, easy and funny. Next, I made a video reading one day boys' favorite books, and for this video I've listened to an audiobook of Nike Shoe Dog, and also read the poetry collection The Pillow Thoughts. Did I like them? No, I did not. Again, there isn't really much I have to add on that topic. If you want me to see talking more about them, you can watch my video reading one day boys' favorite books. The book that I did like from this video, though, is My Policeman by Bethan Roberts, which is going to be made into a film adaptation where Harry Styles is going to be one of the main characters. And I really like this book. I didn't expect to like it, and this is why I think I liked it even more. It's one of the few modern books that I've read this summer, and I was really impressed and I enjoyed it very much. Again, you can hear me rambling on about it. I will just add that I would definitely recommend everyone to read it. The next book I haven't actually read, but I've listened to an audiobook of it, and it's a very light-hearted, I would definitely recommend it for a good summer read, and it's Dracula by Bram Stoker. I don't know why I chose this time to read it, but I wanted to know what it's about, and I thought that it was the first ever mentioning of such a vampire as Dracula. Actually, it wasn't. When I searched a little bit about its history, I found out that it was like kind of a folk story about vampires, and people just believed that vampires exist, and that inspired writers of that time to write works about different vampires, and then that also inspired Bram Stoker to create Dracula, and he just became one of the most popular vampire characters because there was a whole story about like about copyright, because there was like a play that was based on Dracula, that it didn't give credit to Dracula, and then there was this whole story about people finding out that it was inspired by Dracula, and they started reading this book because of that. But still, I found it interesting to read, well, not read it, but hear it, because I guess this is the story that inspired the most of modern writers to make stories about vampires, and it was just interesting to see what was the root for it. Next one is also pretty light-hearted and easy to read at summer, a very cute story called Murder on the Orient Express by Agatha Christie. I wanted to read it in the winter time. This book was actually a gift by my friend, but I've been putting it away for such a long time, and I felt kind of embarrassed for it. And then I went on a road trip, and having nothing better to do, I was reading it, and I just finished it in one day. And I know I joked about it being lighthearted, but I still liked it. It wasn't really dark, yet it does involve a murder. I hardly know her. Okay. Stupid joke alert. Still, it was kind of funny because the main detective, Hercule Poirot, is kind of a funny guy. It also brought me back to my roots because I haven't read a detective in a while, and detective is something that got me into reading in the first place. But I gave it 4 out of 5 stars just because by the end it was getting a little bit irritating because because he was like, I've known who the murderer is for this whole time. But first, let's interrogate 10 more people, let's see their backs, let's ask what my friends think about it, and like, okay, just say it. If you know who the murderer is, just say it. While we're on this topic, I wanted to also say a few words about the film adaptation, because I watched it right after I read the book. why would you do this? The film adaptation was so bad. If you've only seen the movie and haven't read the book, I'm sorry, read the book and you're gonna like it much, much more. One of the things that I like the most about the book version is the ending, and I'm not gonna spoil anything, I'm just gonna say that it was so funny and it ended on such an easy and witty note, left you with such a good feeling, whereas in the film they made it so dark for no reason and it was super bad. I guess the best compliment I can give to this book is the fact that I've already known the biggest twist about it and I still read it and I still liked it. Okay, now speaking about the things that were actually appropriate to read in summer, I started reading Emma by Jane Austen. This is actually a comedy. I haven't finished it yet and I'm also not gonna talk about it too much because it fits with the video that I'm planning on filming. So you're gonna see me talking about it more in one of my future videos. The thing that I'm gonna say though is that this book has a very weird pacing. Like, something happens and then for 10 chapters nothing happens. And then again something happens, some event, and then again 10 chapters and nothing happens. What I really liked about it though is the characters, because they're all so caricature and you can clearly see each function that they serve for. Okay, I'm not gonna make a full review because I haven't finished it yet, and I am gonna talk about it more in one of my next videos, so I'll stop now. Next book that I've read is The Great Gatsby by F. Scott Fitzgerald, and this left me with very mixed feelings because when I was reading it, I thought that the main idea of this book is the fact that the rich society is so stupid and so hypocrite, and they are not what we think they are. And there was a line that was saying that the Great Gatsby wanted to impress his love interest, and it took him several years to build his personality to impress her. And I thought, okay, this is a line about how the rich society and the things that they do is so meaningless and it's only made to like show other people something about themselves and not to make any actual sense. Then it's kind of like a twist, so I don't know if I should say that, but I don't know, I kind of figure that out by myself before they said it in the book, so I guess that's fine if I say it. The Great Gatsby turned out to be like a drug dealer or something like this, and I thought this is clearly a thought about how the rich society is now not what we think they are. It's not that innocent, and they often become rich because of some scam or because of some bad things that they did, and how like everything is just based on connections that you have and not actual skills. And I thought, okay, this is not a new idea for me to think about, because it's, in our age this is quite a wide topic that had been spoken on a lot of times, but for that time it is probably quite a new idea to be put in a book, you know? And then after this I was like, I'm gonna read some article analyzing it, because what if there's something that I've missed? It's always interesting to read some analysis, right? And then when I'm googling it, all I see is that F. Scott, the author, wanted to write this book to show the sadness of a situation when a guy wants to marry a woman he can't. And as I understood it, he just wanted to like write about his own problem, because he proposed to his wife Zelda twice. First when he was like poor and she didn't accept the proposal, and then he got rich and she accepted the proposal and they married. Oh, poor you! I just didn't like what I've read about the book, I liked my own conclusions better. Also, there is a film adaptation, well, the one which we all know and love with Leonardo DiCaprio, but there is also a British adaptation where Nick Carraway is played by Paul Rudd. And Nick Carraway is not really my favorite character. This is not a book with the most likable characters, like they all have their flaws, and Nick also has his moments, so he wasn't really the most sympathetic guy. But guys, what are you doing when you're putting Paul Rudd to play him. Of course I'm gonna like Nick if Paul Rudd plays him. This is a Paul Rudd stan account. Next, I've also recently finished Maurice by Ian Foster. This was an interesting story about a guy named Maurice, and he's gay, and he's in old England where gay rights aren't figured out yet. But it's not really a sad book. I wouldn't say it has some traumatic moments. Also, the conversations don't feel realistic. Well, probably because of the times that it was written in, but just when it's one of the books that you read and you think, no way people were talking like this, like you don't understand anything from the dialogue. A lot of people call this their favorite book. I wouldn't really say that it was my favorite. I wouldn't really say that it was the most gripping and the most eventful and action-packed, but I still also wanted to read it for a while. And I'm glad I did. I say this about every book that I'm talking about. Oh, no, okay. There is one book that I'm not really glad that I've read. Well, I haven't read it. I've listened to an audiobook of it. It's Untamed by Glenn Doyle, a self-help book that I've read for one of my videos. And you know, as much as I didn't really like it, the thing that I've gained from this book, it's the fact that when kids are coming out to their parents and their parents say, "We love you no matter what," it's not really the best thing to say to your kid. So saying, "We love you no matter what," is almost as saying, "We love you even though you're gay," as if it's a bad thing. So maybe this book isn't that pointless after all. There's still something I've gained from it. But then again, is it that good of a book if there's only one thing to gain? The last three books that I've read this summer were a couple of stories by Edgar Allan Poe, a couple of poems by Allen Ginsberg, and then also I've listened to an audiobook of Being There by Jerzy Kosinski. I hope I pronounced that correct. If not, I'm sorry. But I'm also not gonna talk about them here because I'm making a video for which I've read these books. So you have no choice but to just wait till this video comes out to see me talking about the books. See? What a cliffhanger. Okay, and lastly, I want to make a little to be read for autumn. Hopefully I'm not gonna talk about too many books because I don't want to put the pressure of reading them on myself. The first book that I want to read is The Book Thief. I've seen a couple of people on TikTok reading this and bawling their eyes out, and that's what I want to do. So I want to read it. I've also seen a very cute edition of it in one of the local bookshops, so I'm definitely planning to visit it and buy it. Next, I also wanted to read a couple more detectives because Murder on the Orient Express brought back my love to detectives, and I wanted to read some more. I'm not gonna say which ones though, because I haven't yet picked them, but I definitely want to read some. Next thing I've wanted to read for a long time is The Curious Incident of the Dog in the Nighttime. I actually already know what this book is about. What is the problem with me? Why am I reading books that I know what they are about? But still, I'm curious and I want to read it, so I hope I do this autumn. Next thing I want to read is My Year of Rest and Relaxation. That's a story about a woman who's so depressed she wants to fall asleep for a year, and that's all I really know about it. But I've also heard it being compared to The Bell Jar, because it's also like about a depressed woman. A book about a mentally ill woman? Sign me up. So I want to read it as well. I also really want to put my hands on Northanger Abbey by Jane Austen. This is a work that I've heard about because of Aunt Carly video. She made a video like recommending books to different aesthetics. And when speaking about dark academia, which I am, she said that Northanger Abbey is like your typical Jane Austen novel, but with like some dark mood to it. And I love that. I definitely want to read it. I've been wanting to read it for a long time as well, but I just wanted to wait when autumn hits and the rainy days start and leaves start falling from the trees to just put myself in the appropriate atmosphere to read such a book. The last book that I want to read is To Kill a Mockingbird. This is actually one of the books that Charlie reads in the Perks of Being a Wallflower. And this is also a book that I've heard, like, every single time I've heard it being mentioned. I've heard people say nothing but good things about it. My friend also read it and said that she really likes it. So I'm curious what's happening in there, what's it about. So I definitely want to put my hands on this one as well. Okay, and that was it. Thank you very much for watching. You can follow me on Goodreads if you want, no pressure, but you can also follow me on my Instagram account to see my drawings. And I hope we meet again when my next video comes out. But for now, bye.